Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Grace Family Church Online. We are so excited to have you here with us today. My name is Jalen, and I work here as a zone coach in our children's ministry on Saturday nights. But today, I get to the absolute pleasure of being your online host. Now, last week, we had an amazing opportunity to have baptisms at Fort DeSoto Park, where over 900 people got baptized. Can you say God is good? It was so amazing to see so many people make an outward expression to everyone around them of the inward decision of following Jesus. It was a joyful time filled with worship and praising Jesus, people dedicating their lives to him, and showing everyone that they have decided to be forever changed in Jesus' name. Now, this week, we are on week three of our series, God's Way, where we're talking about relationships. Last week, Pastor Daryl gave an impactful message talking about singleness and the very special devoted life to Jesus. Now, this week, we have Pastor Jonathan Sterrett talking to us about the art of marriage. He's going to dive into some different things, talking about a collaborative relationship with God and having a relational side, not a transactional side. So stay tuned and focus in, take some notes. Now, speaking of marriage, we have Marriage Conference coming up May 3rd and 4th. So sign up on the GFC app or GFC online. You will not want to miss it. We have some amazing speakers. Again, thank you so much for joining us today. I am so excited and expectant for all that God is going to do today. So make sure, grab a notebook, grab your Bible, open it up with us, because we're about to spend some time worshiping together. So whether you're sitting in your comfy chair or standing in your living room, let's all get ready to praise the King together.
Together, let's fill this room with worship today. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. God, we fill this room. Come on, lift up your worship right now. Thank him for his faithfulness. Thank him for his goodness. Thank him that you woke up this morning. He's worthy. Lord, we desire to meet with you today, to receive from you. All belongs to you. We're full of expectation. We're gonna see you move. Where two or more are gathered, there's power in the room. You're all our hearts are after. There's nothing you can't do.
Let everything with breath raise up a holy sound from east to west till earth and heaven's praises shake the ground. Every voice raise up a holy sound. Yeah. We might be facing mountains, seen them move before, where miracles can happen. Praise opens up the door, so we lift our voices louder.
Yeah. Forever change. Scriptural truth in songs. And you know, in this room, it's easy to say, all hail King Jesus. But I think we could agree out there in the world, they're not saying, all hail King Jesus. And there's a reason for that. He hasn't come as a king yet. This song's about a future time. See, Jesus has three roles to fulfill: prophet, priest, and king. When he came 2,000 years ago, he came as a prophet, proclaiming God's truth and revealing God's plan for the future. And then when he rose to heaven, it says he's seated at the right hand of the Father, interceding for us as our high priest. But he's coming back as a king, guys. And I believe it's soon. The sky's gonna rip open. He's gonna descend. He's gonna land on the Mount of Olives. He's gonna walk into Jerusalem, and he's gonna rule and reign for 1,000 years. And then every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. Guys, we're gonna do this for 1,000 years. I think we should practice it a little bit. So one more time, let's sing like he's our King of Kings.
All hail this.
That was awesome, guys. Great job. Hey, take that same energy, turn around, give somebody a high five, tell them you're glad they're here today. Woo! Everybody catch your breath. That was awesome. Hey, if you're visiting with us for the first time, we just want to say welcome to Grace Family Church and hello. And the best way for you to say hello back to us is take out your phone and text the word hello to 81313. That'll just give us an indication you were here today. I'd love to meet you personally, shake your hand, and maybe answer any questions you have about how you can make Grace Family Church feel like your home. And guys, right now we're going to continue to worship through giving. So as our ushers are coming forward, let's just pause and bless God for all he's done for us. Father, in Jesus' name, we love you. Thank you so much for blessing us, Father. Thank you for sending Jesus to die in our place, Father. Just we pray that you take this offering, further it for your kingdom and your work in Tampa Bay and around the world. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, thank you so much for your generous giving. And we always talk about, you know, why we give. And at Grace Family Church, we are generational, guys. And we have right now Cody and Katie are coming up, and they're going to share some next gen stuff with us.
Let's go. Come on. My name is Cody. If we haven't got the chance to meet yet, I am our United Youth Pastor here at the Lutz Campus. Yeah, and what's your name?
My name is Katie, and I'm in 11th grade at Cambridge Christian School.
Let's go. Come on. Hey, listen, if you've got a student or you know a student that loves Jesus or doesn't love Jesus but needs a little bit of Jesus or is pursuing Jesus, then we want to encourage you, come on out. Have them come out on Wednesday night, because every single Wednesday night, we've got a place where you can worship Jesus, where you can pursue him, and you can make friends that are doing the same. And we think that every 6th through 12th grader needs to be here. We do it every single Wednesday night right here on our Lutz campus. And this Wednesday, we actually got something special going on. So, Katie, why don't you tell us a little bit?
Okay, so this Wednesday we have Youth Night right here at 7 p.m. at this campus. So basically what Youth Night is it's a night run by students, and it's for students. So we're gonna have student testimonies, student messages, we have games planned all by students, and the theme that we chose for this week was Piece by Piece. So we would love for all of you 6th through 12th grade students to come out and be a part of what God's doing in Tampa Bay and right here on this campus.
Come on, God is moving in Tampa Bay. Listen, Katie, you're only 11th grade, right? That's crazy. Listen, she said, by the youth, for the youth. This whole night is planned by our students, for our students. We took a step back and we thought, you know what, why do we keep saying what we need to be talking about? They would know a little bit better. So every single Wednesday night, one of us gives a message. And I'll tell you what, God moves. But there's something special when students bring the word to their peers and they really preach it. And so we've got 3 students, and Katie is actually one of our people, one of our students that is preaching this Wednesday night. And I'm so excited to see what God does through her and through our other speakers and even the other students that are just leading. And man, God is gonna move. So if you've got a 6th through 12th grader or you know one, tell them they need to come on out, because it's for the youth, by the youth. Cool? All right.
Good job. Great, guys. Man, I love seeing the next generation serving the kingdom and helping build it up. That was awesome. Thank you, guys. Now, guys, listen, we are still riding the wave of beach baptism, pun intended. Guys, we celebrate 940 baptisms last week. How about it? And every one of those numbers is a story. It's not just the big number, it's the one. And one that comes to mind is a guy started coming here about 2 years ago, and last year I had the privilege of baptizing him. And he's the oldest of 6 children, and his brother came to the baptism last year just to see what was going on with his brother that he wasn't so sure of. And he observed him. He started coming to church. A few months ago, his brother and his brother's girlfriend walked down the aisle, gave their lives to Jesus, and last week they got baptized at beach baptism. So guys, as big as that number is, it's all about that one, and you are that one story. You are that visible testimony to somebody in your family, somebody in your work, and there's so many other stories. We don't have enough time to tell them, but we're gonna share a few more. Check this out.
Baptism to me is an outward expression to the world that I've received Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior.
Lord has really shown me that even though I don't have an earthly father, that he is my father.
I went to this one United service and I accepted Jesus into my heart, and I wanted to show the world.
Hi, I'm Maria.
And I'm Robert.
And we've been made new.
Jackson Pecoroni, and today I've been made new.
And we've been made new.
Today I've been made new.
Made new.
Made new today.
And we've been made new.
God gave me a new purpose. Baptism means giving me a fresh start at life.
Today is a starting point from my walk with Christ, and everything in the past is the past. That's not who I am anymore.
Like, you show the world that you have given your heart to Jesus and that you are ready to follow him wherever he goes.
Why don't we give it up for 947? Man. Here is my favorite part about a day like beach baptisms. That's 947 different people. To us, that's a crowd. To God, these are 947 individual stories. And he is God with us, which means when they take a step, he steps with them. He's that big, he's that good. Let's give it up for our God who leads us and guides us every step of the way. We've been talking about God's way over the last few weeks, having a great time, talking about healthy boundaries in relationships, very important, talking about the benefits of singleness. And today I have the honor to talk about the art of marriage. The art of marriage. If you don't know me, my name's Jonathan. I'm the children's pastor here at Grace, which means along with my incredible team, we are responsible to take the word of God and make it applicable to your kiddos. It is a great challenge and a great joy, especially in those moments when you see the light bulb go off in a child's heart and eyes and they understand who God is. There is nothing greater than that. I love my job. I'm also a proud husband and a father of two, and I have a particular passion for God's design for family. I just think it works. And when we work it, it grows us, it challenges us in all of the right ways. It's God's way, it's God's design. And so I wanna talk about a big piece of God's design today, but before we get into the art of marriage, I wanna talk to two groups of people, okay? The first group of people are those of you who are not married, and you're sitting back right now like, well, here we go, the next 30 minutes of my life, I have to sit here and listen to a message about marriage that doesn't apply to me. I promise you, that's not the kind of day this is. Today, we are gonna be teaching from the Word of God. And in Isaiah 55:11, it says, his word does not return void, but it accomplishes what it sets out to do. So what does this word set out to do? To challenge us, to change us, and to transform us. So today, I believe even if you're not married, this word will change you, challenge you, and transform you. And if you are married, this is the second group of people, or if you have been married before, I wanna just come right out and say the obvious, marriage is tough. Marriage is hard. It's difficult. And because marriage is difficult, today is not going to be about judgment. We're not going to compare marriages. I don't want to be impressed with us. I want to be impressed with the God who designed marriage. I want to look to his character and ask the question, what is so important to him about marriage? And so as an act of goodwill, I'm going to put my imperfect marriage under the microscope for all of you just to break the ice. Does that sound good? Okay, thought it would. All right. How many of you guys are Dashboard Confessional fans? Come on, millennials, don't let me down. Don't let me down. If you don't know who Dashboard Confessional is, about 15, 20 years ago, there was this big group of people called the emos, all right? The emo group. And they had like their hair over one eye was peeking out. They were usually wearing all black, super skinny jeans. They were listening to Dashboard Confessional. That's all you need to know, okay? So imagine the most whiny rock is playing in the background of this story, all right? I'm 17, going on 18. This girl named Rachel is 16, going on 17. This is not The Sound of Music, by the way. This is my actual life. And the first day that I met Rachel, our families got together. I saw her across the way. We met in the park, and I said exactly zero words to her. I'm pretty sure it was zero words to her on that first day. You could say I was taking the slow approach, maybe, perhaps. You could say I didn't have any social skills to speak of, and I was trying to develop them. But a year later, our relationship kicked it into high gear, and I'll tell you what I mean.
I decided I was gonna join the youth group worship band, all right? And who else had decided to join the youth group worship band but this girl, Rachel? And I looked over across the stage and I saw this beautiful, young, unique, cool-looking, confident girl playing the bass. I was like, ooh, that's cool, I like that. I was over here on keys and synth. I was the guy that when the youth pastor gives the spirited altar call, I'm like, same two chords over and over. That was me. So we started talking because we were both in the band. We started trading music we liked. I made her a mix CD. Come on now. How many of you guys like won your spouse's heart with a mix CD? It works. And so that was fantastic. Good connection there. We kept talking and I realized right away, I really liked this girl. And I'll tell you why I liked her so much was because she was no nonsense. Okay, and a lot of girls I was hanging out with in those days, they were like all nonsense, okay? They would be like flirtatious one day and then they would ghost you the next day. I do like you, no, I don't. I'm just kidding. I hate that stuff. Don't do that stuff. And Rachel was the opposite. I mean, she was straight down the line, consistent, spoke her mind, didn't play games, didn't waste my time. I knew I liked her immediately and I was pretty sure she liked me. And then I proceeded to take an entire year to make my move on her. An entire year. I don't know what I was waiting for, okay? I was waiting for a little burst of confidence. I was waiting for my final growth spurt, perhaps. I was waiting for, you millennials will know what I'm saying, her to make me her top friend on MySpace. You know that top eight? I wanted to be the top, at least the top four. Make me the top four, then I'll ask you out. The rest of you have no idea what we're talking about, but that's okay. Finally, I made my move, okay? This is where things really accelerated because we dated for a whole year and then we got engaged for 4 months and then boom, 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 we were married, okay? 21 and 20 years old. We got married young. And this is what we looked like when we got married. You're gonna have to ask her what she saw in that Harry Potter lump of clay. She saw potential, I could do something with this. And I'm glad she decided to say yes. But it was tough, it was a risk getting married so young because as we were just learning to become adults, we were learning how to become married adults at the same time. And it was bumpy. We both made a ton of mistakes. And it was, we almost didn't make it at a certain point. We were this close to calling it off. But it's only by the grace of God, and I don't mean this lightly, the grace of God, that we have been married this weekend, 16 years is our anniversary. Thank you. And again, I want to emphasize the imperfection of our marriage. We have an imperfect marriage in which we have both made lots of mistakes. Hurt each other accidentally, misunderstood one another, done the wrong thing when we should have done the right thing for 16 years. Marriage is hard, but I like to call our marriage a perfectly imperfect marriage. Why? Why are we talking about marriage on a weekend? Shouldn't we just save it for the marriage conference, which is coming up May 3rd through 4th? Sign up, guys, sign up! But why are we talking about it all together? Does everybody really need to know about marriage? Here's why I think it's applicable to everyone. The reason why is when we look in God's word, we realize that marriage is actually God's self-portrait. See, he created the heavens and the earth with his mouth, and then he slowed down and said, what I'm gonna do next, I'm gonna do with my hands. The Bible says he formed us. And he said, how can I be thoughtful and considerate about a way that what I create next is going to reflect me? This is why he says this in Genesis 1:27. God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. He made us to look like him. And when we're unified in marriage, it's supposed to reflect his character. Anything that he creates to show us more of himself is worthy of our attention, whether we're married or not. But here's what I think is kind of funny, but also a little bit sad. The world has very little to offer in the way of marriage advice. Like when you Google or go on YouTube and look for self-help, oh man, you get all sorts of stuff about self-help. But when it comes to marriage, there's surprisingly little out there. And here's my theory about this. My theory is that culture has really learned to emphasize the moment. It's all about the moment in life, moments in your life that are important. And marriage is incredibly hard to fit into a moment. And so what a lot of people have done is they've tried to retrofit marriage to become just one moment in their life with an emergency exit. And this is what the statistics show us, that almost 50% of all marriages in the U.S. end in divorce or separation. So that means 41% of first marriages end in divorce. That means 60% of second marriages end in divorce. 73% of third marriages end in divorce. And the U.S. is number 6, highest divorce rate in the world. Why? Because marriage is hard, especially marriages that are meant to last. And we need help. I want to say to you right now, it is impossible to stay married without help. So where does our help come from? It comes from the one who originated marriage, God himself, who in the very beginning created the institution of marriage for the purpose of reflecting him, which means the praiseworthy parts of my marriage are the parts that reflect a praiseworthy God. And so as we look at the art of marriage and we ask the question, how is a good marriage like God? We have to look to the beginning of the story. And one of the first things we see about God and about his nature and about his character is that God is a collaborative God. He has a collaborative nature. He's collaborative and not competitive. So a couple months ago, my wife and I wanted to put up a shelf in my son Elliot's room. And there's some background you should know about us. Rachel's father was an electrician. My father was a musician. And so because of that, Rachel is like light years ahead of me in the field of home repair. And yes, it is a source of wounded pride for me. And I am constantly trying to prove to her that I know what I'm doing, even though I do not. And so this was one of those opportunities. I said, I'm gonna show some initiative. It's good, right? It's good. So I'm gonna go into the garage, I'm gonna grab the tools, I'm going to take the tools and walk by Rachel slowly so she can see I'm taking initiative to put up the shelf. And as I do so, she's like, hey, what are you doing there? And I'm like, obviously I'm putting up this shelf with the tools because I'm a good husband. She's like, oh yeah? Yeah, you're gonna put up that shelf? You're gonna put that shelf up with that tire pressure gauge that you have right there in your hand? This is a true story, guys. I'm not making this up. I look down and I go, oh, it does look very similar to a stud finder. I mean, come on, they both have digital readouts. They're basically the same thing. I was boiling though at that point. I was boiling because, see, when it comes down to it, I want to be smart, but I don't want to just be smart. I want to be right. And when my wife is right and I'm not right, something in me, it's probably my sinful nature, let's be honest, sucks me into this framework where I am now a competitor with my wife. And no matter what, I've got to be right. I've got to be more right than her. I've got to lord it over her in whatever possible way I can, especially if she's right. I got to kick it into high gear and be more right. And God says, what are you doing? Marriage is an art. You are misframing the art of marriage to be about competition when it is about collaboration. Why do we know this? Because God in his very nature is collaborative. The verse before the one I just read you, Genesis 1:26 says, let us make man in our image. Who is God talking about? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, a collaborative God. And collaboration is so deep in his nature, he knew that it would be good for us. This is why in the creation account, God goes through 6 days of creation. He says, this is good, that's good, that's good. Then he creates man, puts him alone in the world. He says, oh, that's not good. Genesis 2:18, the Lord God said, it's not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper who is just right for him. And so God creates man and woman, two equal sides of one image, collaboration. There's two Hebrew words I want us to note in this passage. The first one is the Hebrew word for image. It's tselem, T-S-E-L-E-M. It is the same word that God uses later when he's talking to Moses about the Ten Commandments. And he says, I don't want you to have any tselem, any images, any idols. What is the connection? God is saying, I have created the perfect reflection of me in you, A collaboration is the perfect reflection of me. So when you separate from that, when you become now a competitor instead of a collaborator, you are making yourself an idol. You are taking the spotlight off of me, which your collaboration produces an image of, and putting it on you to say, I'm the right one, I'm the good one, pay attention to me, not her. That is an idol. God says, don't do it. Competition is not in my nature. I am a collaborator by nature. This is why Ephesians 5:28-29 says this, in the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. Listen to this part. No one hates his own body, but feeds and cares for it, just as Christ cares for the church. Married couples, we are one. When we attack each other, we're attacking ourselves. God says, what are you doing? Don't literally shoot yourself in the foot. Do not hurt yourself. Collaborate with your spouse. And if you're not married, this same principle applies to you and the church. God says, I want you to collaborate. The more you close yourself off from the body of Christ, the more you make yourself an idol. But if you get in a group, if you surround yourself with people who can comfort you, who can see the good in you, but who can also challenge you, you are becoming a collaborator and you are fitting perfectly into the image of God. This is what Jesus says in John 17 before he goes to the cross. I am in them, he's talking to the Father. I am in them and you are in me. May they experience such perfect unity. Could you say that really loud with me? Perfect unity. Perfect unity. Say it more unified. Perfect unity. Perfect unity. In such perfect unity that the world will know that you sent me and that you love them as much as you love me. What did Jesus just say? He said that the more unified we are, the more committed we are to collaboration, the more the world is going to see the image of God. The more we're gonna be the city on a hill. And every time we compete instead of collaborate, that city on a hill gets dimmer and dimmer and dimmer because it becomes about us and not about him. Now, collaboration is not easy. We know this, and God knows this because he collaborates with us. Can you imagine being God in all of his godness collaborating with us? Like, he's probably up in heaven like, okay. That's okay. Because of his nature, he has decided to work through us, even though he could do a much better job in a fraction of the time and way less frustration. He says, no, I'm gonna work through my people. Shouldn't we even more decide to humble ourselves, become collaborators instead of competitors so that we can show the image of God and reflect him well? Now, Matthew 19, Jesus says, and in 1 Corinthians 7, Paul says, that sometimes it's better not to marry. And I think Pastor Daryl did a phenomenal job last week talking about the benefits of singleness. Sometimes it's not always about marriage, but either way, this is what it's about, collaboration. As a church, we are supposed to collaborate, not compete. But collaboration takes relationship. In order to collaborate with somebody, you gotta know them. You gotta learn them. This is why God is relational. God's a relational God. He's not transactional. How many of you guys hate small talk? Be honest with me. A lot of you. All of you should get to know my wife. You would love her. She hates small talk, okay? Sometimes she goes and she sits in the car because she knows after church, I'm gonna take an hour and a half to talk to everybody. And she's like, yo, my legs are not built for that kind of small talk, okay? I am all about the real talk. I'm gonna tell you a story about Rachel and how much she's about the real talk, how she gets to the point. But before I do, there's something you need to know about my wife that is truly phenomenal. 10 years ago, Rachel opened the Bible. She read about the life of Jesus and she saw miracles, signs, and wonders. Then she read along, she sees Jesus dies, rose again, and then ascends to heaven, and then the church continues with what? Miracles, signs, and wonders. And then she looks at her life and she says, where are the miracles, signs, and wonders? The Bible says Jesus promises that I will do the same and even greater things. So what's missing? I need to build my faith. I need to actually ask for the impossible. And Rachel has been so encouraging, challenging to me as she has prayed bold prayers and seen miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle because of her faith being built for the impossible. Now, Our story we're about to tell here takes place at the very beginning of that journey. Rachel's just building up her faith muscles, learning how to pray bold prayers. Her and I are on a date. We're going to the movie theater. This older gentleman is coming out of the movie theater, and this guy has like a bent leg. It's bent in a way that God didn't intend. It doesn't look like it's very good to walk on. He looks like he's in pain. And before I know it, Rachel just bolts over to this guy. And I'm talking no pretense, no small talk. Hey, how's it going? What movie did you see? She goes, hey, I noticed your leg is bent. Can I pray for it? I'm like, oh my gosh, that's bold, Rachel. It's like when you're afraid your kid is gonna say something about the person. You're like, don't say anything. She said it. She called it out. And I'm like, butter him up, Rachel. Like, ask him how he's doing, how the weather is. Maybe compliment his shoes and then work your way up to the leg, maybe. That's a way to kind of ease into it. But no, straight for the leg, she goes. And this man did let her pray for him, but then he was meow, just out of there. He peeled out. It was a little too direct. The real talk was too much for him. But I'm gonna tell you something about the character of God. The character of God is a lot like Rachel. Get past the small talk, get to the real you. God wants the real us. Let me define small talk in God's eyes. Small talk is when we raise our hands in worship, but then we go home and we don't surrender our hearts to him. And here's what God has to say when he's at his wit's end with the Israelites who are small talking with all these pleasantries, sacrifices, rituals, but they refuse to give him their hearts. He says this in Isaiah 1:13-14. Stop bringing me your meaningless gifts. This is God talking to people. The incense of your offerings disgusts me. Whew. As for your celebrations of the new moon and the Sabbath and your special days for fasting, they're sinful and false. I want no more of your pious meetings. I hate your new moon celebrations and your annual festivals. They're a burden to me. I cannot stand them. God says, I don't care about your small talk. I want the real you. Now, if you're walking with God day after day, sharing with him your thoughts, that's not small talk to God. That is relationship. That's what he wants more of. And I love Psalm 51 because the psalmist starts to catch on to the character of God, how God is relational and not transactional. Here's what he says. Psalm 51:16-17 says, you do not desire a sacrifice, God. Otherwise, I would offer one. You don't even want a burnt offering, do you? No, you don't care about that. I understand you now. The sacrifice you desire is a broken spirit. My broken spirit is what you want. You will not reject a broken and repentant heart, O God. This is why God sent Jesus as the final sacrifice. He says, enough of your rituals and rules. It is finished. Now it's time for you to give me your heart, your whole heart. That's all that's left. No more rituals, no more rules, no more transactions. Give me your heart. This is the art of marriage. God calls us into a relationship, a covenant and not a contract. What's the difference between a covenant and a contract? Well, in a contract, you protect your rights. You limit your responsibilities. You hold the other at an arm's distance. A covenant is the exact opposite. You give up your rights. You take responsibility. You cover over the mistakes of the other because of your great love for them. This is the kind of covenant relationship God calls us to in our marriages, not just with our spouse. It's not just a covenant with our spouse. It's a covenant with God and our spouse. When God creates the woman in Genesis, the word helper is actually the Hebrew word ezer kenegdo. Ezer kenegdo. This word means strong, complementary, rescuer. This is the same word God uses for himself when he leads Israel out of Egypt. Another way to describe this word ezer kenegdo is Proverbs 31:26. When she speaks, her words are wise. She gives instructions with kindness. This means Rachel, ezer kenegdo, my wife, is fit to stand face to face with me and make up for everything that I lack. It's a gift. It's not a judgmental thing. It's a relational thing where she can say, I know where you're limited and I know how to compliment you, to make up for the things you lack. This is a gift from God. And if I don't listen to my spouse, I'm actually denying God's help for me. So what's the most practical way to cultivate a relational marriage? Here it is, super simple. Pray together. Pray together. Pray together every day consistently. Pray together when you feel like it. Pray together when you don't feel like it. But don't make it a transaction, make it a relational prayer. And listen, guys, I'm not talking long prayers. Please, don't make it painful for both you and your spouse. You don't always have to prophesy over your spouse. You don't have to call fire down from heaven for your spouse. I'm talking 30 seconds. Yeah, I'm talking 1 minute, 2 minutes, 5 minutes. Short and sweet, baby. Short and sweet. Take your spouse's hand, look them in the eyes, ask them how they're doing. What can I pray for you for? And then invite the presence of Almighty God to come and be the center of your marriage. When that happens, come on. When that happens, God has the ability to snap your marriage back into alignment with His design. It's so simple, but it's relational. Can't be transactional. It's gotta be relational. God's gonna see right through that transaction. A transaction's anything that stands in the way of where relationship is supposed to go. That means going through the motions in any way where relationship and connection is needed. That's a transaction. God doesn't want it, can't stand it. Wants the real us. Relational God who calls for relational marriages. And it's a contract. A contract is give and take. That's not what marriage is. That's not what God asks for. He wants a covenant, which is a give, 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 without holding back. Why? Because God didn't hold back himself. He didn't hold back. He gave all that he had for us. And this is because God leads with love and not with law. 7 years ago, my wife and I made the fateful decision to take a family cruise. A couple years ago, we'd taken a couple's cruise. It was beautiful. Everything that was great about the couple's cruise was the opposite about this family cruise, all right? And I'm about to tell you what I mean. But first, you gotta understand this. So on this cruise, this family cruise, Rachel decided to invite her friend and her friend's boyfriend to come along with us. And so we knew that there was gonna be a stop in Cozumel, so we made a little plan. We said, okay, Rachel, her friend's boyfriend, they're gonna split off. They're gonna go into Cozumel because they had this hobby of taking photos. They wanted to go take photos in Cozumel. That's great. Because what I wanna do is I wanna chill on the boat. I wanna soak up the sun. And so I will go to the pool with the kids. They'll go into Cozumel. We'll have a great day. And it was a great day. It was a great day until the day was almost over, and then it took a very dark turn. So I'm drying off my kids because we know it's time for dinner soon, and I thought I heard my name over the loudspeaker. But why would one hear their name over the loudspeaker? That's weird. So I was like, wrapped my kids in their towels, went down the stairs towards our room, and sure enough,
Jonathan Sterrett, please report to the front desk, Jonathan Sterrett.
I'm like, that's me, I'm Jonathan Sterrett. This is not good. And parents, you're gonna know what I mean. I mean, our kids' timing sometimes is impeccable because right when that starts to go wrong, they kick it into high gear with their complaining. You know what I'm talking about? Dad, I'm really cold and hungry and wet and I want a hamburger and I want Skittles and Oreos and I wanna... And I'm like, oh my gosh. So I take my complaining, ungrateful children, I take them down to the front desk, put them in the corner, because I don't know what front desk guy is about to tell me and I don't want my kids to hear it. So I go up to the front desk and I say, yes. He says, Jonathan Sterrett, that's me. He goes, well, sir, have some news for you. We wanted to leave the dock about 20 minutes ago, but we cannot. And it's because three passengers are still not accounted for. And those three passengers are your wife, your wife's friend, and you guessed it, your wife's friend's boyfriend. And I'm like, wait, what are you talking about? You mean like they're somewhere on the boat? He's like, no, sir, they're not on the boat at all. They're somewhere in Mexico. We don't know where they are. And suddenly, my life becomes a movie. Everything is slow motion, right? There's people like merrymaking all around me. Yay! I look in the corner, there's my kids. The guy at the front desk, sir? And I am realizing that I've got to take my two cold, wet, soft kids, turn them into hardened Jason Bourne assassins, because we're going into Cozumel. We got to find my wife, Rachel. We have got to find the drug cartel that kidnapped her. So I snap back into reality. He says, sir, you've got to make a decision. I'm like, whoa, what? What kind of decision are we talking about? He goes, well, sir, you can either stay with your kids on the boat or you can take your kids into Cozumel and we're gonna leave you. That's my choices? These are my choices you're giving me? And I realized this is the worst moment of my life, most stressful thing that's ever happened to me. Sweat down my face, the room is spinning, and I have no idea what to do. I'm panicking, I'm terrified. Thankfully, saved by the bell, the phone rings, man at the desk, hello? Uh-huh. Oh, wow, okay. And I go, what? He says, well, sir, apparently, your wife, your wife's friend, and your wife's friend's boyfriend, they lost track of time. They were in downtown Cozumel when they realized they needed to be back at the boat, and they freaked out. So they got a cab, they NASCAR'd their way back to the dock. In the meantime, the captain told everybody on the boat that we were still waiting for three passengers before we left. So everybody goes out on their balcony staring at the dock, waiting for those three, and who comes running up the dock but my wife, my wife's friend, and my wife's friend's boyfriend. Ah! Like it's out of a movie, slow motion, Chariots of Fire. Everybody starts cheering for them because they cannot wait to leave the dock. My wife is humiliated. They get to the entrance of the boat, and who is awaiting them? Who steps out? But the captain himself, stern face, berating them. How dare you? I've never left a passenger on my watch. You almost made me leave you. Get on the boat. Humiliated in front of everybody. And so the guy at the desk says, hey, everything's fine. You may go. And I'm like, everything's fine. I may go. A minute ago, I was a widower. And now everything's fine. Took a deep breath, and I realized, okay, now I'm angry. Now I'm angry at my wife for putting me through that minute and a half of pure trauma that I will never get over. Remember how I told you my wife's smarter than me? This was my moment. This was my one time that I could hold it over her, I could take her heart in my hand, and I could squeeze, baby, I could squeeze. So I take my kids, I'm like, go, up to the room. I wanted to rush to the room. I wanted to be there before her. I wanted to be ready. I wanted to be perched when she walks in the room, just ready to lay down the law. After all those times you told me I was holding a tire pressure gauge to put up a shelf, this is my moment. She comes in, really sheepish, closes the door behind her. I'm just about to pounce. Holy Spirit, as only the Holy Spirit can, nudges me and says, hey, ruins my moment. Completely ruins my moment that I was waiting for. He says, hey, let me ask you a question, buddy. Why'd you get married? I'm like, what are you talking about? Holy Spirit says, why did you get married? Did you get married to win? Did you get married, commit your life to this person so you could constantly lord it over them? Or did you get married to reflect me in your marriage? Because if it's the second one, I've got something to tell you about me. Remember when I didn't lord it over you? Remember when you made all those mistakes? Did I expose them? Or did my love cover them? Did I give you the absolute best that I had to cover over your mistakes? Did I give you my son Jesus to cover your mistakes? Did he take on your mistakes? Did he go first while you were still a sinner, up on the cross with your sins, put them in the grave for you? Before you even knew his name, before you even knew what you'd done wrong, why did you get married? Are you gonna rise to the occasion? Are you gonna climb the mountain with me to the higher standard of the art of marriage to reflect me to the world? Or are you gonna make your point? Go ahead. Well, God, when you put it that way, gosh, sorry. So I went up to Rachel, I said, you had a hard day, huh? She said, I'm so sorry. And I'm so glad that I didn't lay down the law. God helped me there, because I wanted to. Oh, I wanted to. God says, that's not what we're called to do. See, marriage isn't about what we deserve. God didn't give us what we deserve. Thank God he didn't give us what we deserve. But men, this is the way he paints the picture for us. For husbands, this means love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave up his life for her. Yeah, I'll love you when you respect me. That's not the way Christ died for us. We didn't respect him when he died. We didn't respect him on the cross, but he did it anyway. And his love covers a multitude of our sins to show us how to reflect him in marriage. This is the art of marriage. When we feel like competing, God calls us to be collaborative. When we feel lazy, we don't feel like relating to our spouse, having relationship, God says, do it anyway. And when we feel like we are right, and it is not our fault, and it is not fair, God says, yeah, your sin wasn't my fault, but I took responsibility for it. Will you do the same thing in your marriage? Will you practice the art of marriage the way it was designed, to reflect to a dying and lost world the kind of love that goes beyond our own natural love? It is a supernatural love that is begging to be reflected in our marriages. If only we'll climb the mountain with God and say, not my way, but your way. Take me each step of the way, God, because I don't know how to do this marriage thing. It's too hard. My human side just wants to compete, just wants to make my spouse look bad, just wants to complain, argue. But God, you have a higher way. It's funny to me that in the creation account in Genesis 3, when it was just Adam, you don't see any sign of the devil. But when it's Adam and Eve, the devil shows up. Why? Because he hates this. This is the art of marriage. It's a seamless relationship. And from the very beginning, the devil is trying to do everything he can to put a seam in this relationship. Fear, bitterness, jealousy, anything he can possibly get his hands on to put a seam in the relationship that God said, nothing can separate you from this kind of love. When we have collaborative marriages instead of competitive marriages, seamless. Relational marriages instead of transactional marriages, seamless. We lead with love in our marriages, not with laws, seamless relationship. Enemy hates the art of marriage. This is why we're called to love it. This is why we're called to fight for it. And if you're not married in here today, this extends to you in the church. It does. Collaborate with the church. Find your group, find your people. Love people the way that God loved you. Man, if you're dealing with unforgiveness, remember that the bedrock, the foundation of salvation is that God forgave us. Why are we holding on to things? It's time to let go. It's time to collaborate, relate, and love. Snap together into God's design to become the image of him for the world to see. It's the art of marriage, and it is worth fighting for. So if you're here today and you're hearing about a collaborative God, a God that leads with relationship and love, maybe the Holy Spirit is tugging on your heart. I want you to know the Holy Spirit prepared you for this moment. Yeah, that's how much he loves you. He paved the way for you to be right here, and he's tugging on your heart. He's speaking to you. He's knocking on your door. Let me tell you what God did for you. He took the sins you haven't even committed yet, and he put them on his precious possession, his son. And when Jesus died with those sins that were not his fault, but he made them his responsibility, he put that sin in the grave. He died with those sins, but then he rose again because he wanted to prove to you that death to life is your story now. All we have to do is receive this gift. There is nothing we do to earn it or deserve it. God is that big and that good. He says, here it is. Believe and receive. Say yes. If God has led you to that moment, it's time. It's your relationship. You get to take that step. And if you don't have a relationship with him yet, you require and you desire that seamless relationship that he offers, I want you to pray this prayer with me. You can pray it in your heart, in your spirit. You don't have to pray it out loud, but agree with me as I pray. Because it's as simple as saying yes to him. That's how simple he made it. That's how much he loves you, to step with him. So let's take this step together. Say, Father, thank you. Thank you for the sacrificial gift of your son, Jesus, that changes me from the inside out. I know I am a sinner. I know that I don't deserve it and I didn't earn it, but I receive it as a gift with gratitude and with hope. And I know I will never be the same. Change me from the inside out. Become my leader, my savior, my provider, my everything. I will give you my life. I give you my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you made that decision, get ready. God promises exceedingly, abundantly, beyond you could ever ask or think. That is his promise to you, but you have to take those steps. And so now I'm gonna invite your campus pastor up to give you those next steps.
All right, hey, if you made that decision today, you have made the greatest decision you'll ever make, and we want to celebrate that with you. Our prayer team is up here, and they've got some resources for you, and maybe you're not ready to come forward, but you could text YES to 81313. You should let somebody know that you made that decision today so we can celebrate, rejoice with you, and just follow up a little bit. And we've got a class coming up starting this Wednesday. It's called Discovering Jesus, and it's for anybody that has just some more questions about their faith, like, what about God? What about the Bible? What about baptism? Things like that. What about prayer? How does that work? That class is a 5-week class starting Wednesday night. If you text CONNECT to 81313, it's about the third option down. You can scroll down, register for that class. We'd love to have you there and just help grow in your faith. And if you have a need for prayer for anything else, we're here for you. Come forward. We love you guys. Have a great day. God bless.
Whoa, what an amazing message from Pastor Jonathan today. Learning that our God is collaborative, relational, and a loving God. If you made the step to accept Jesus into your life today, text YES to 81313. We want to talk to you and give you some resources to help you on this journey. Well, I hope everyone has an amazing Sunday. We love you and we hope to see you next week. We'll be right back.